Recorded Books and RB Digital present Jack and the Geniuses 2 in the Deep Blue Sea by Bill Nye and Gregory Mone. Illustrated by Nick Iluzada. Narrated by Jonathan Todd Ross. Chapter 1. Inside the Underplane. The cliffs of Nihoa Island stood tall as we soared above the calm blue water. Nihoa means toothed in Hawaiian, but the jagged mass of gray-green rock jutting up out of the Pacific Ocean looked like the rotten molar of a sea monster. We were flying low in a small six-seater airplane, and I really, really didn't want to crash into that tooth. For about the 15th time, I checked my seatbelt. Our pilot, the bazillionaire computer scientist Ashley Hawking, was rambling about the annoying birds that nested on the island. But I didn't care about finches or swallows. An eagle could have chest-bumped my window, and it would not have shifted my focus. If we continued on our current course, we were going to smash into the jagged wall like an egg launched from a slingshot. The plane's engine roared. My stomach spun. Next to me, my brother was staring straight ahead, eyes bulging, with his thin black notebook computer open on his lap. I grabbed his shoulder. His muscles were as solid as rocks, and his face was a greenish shade of white. "Matt?" I asked. "Is she pulling up?" His mouth barely opened. "I hope so," he mumbled. Our sister, Ava, was sitting in the row behind us, watching the flashing red and green numbers on the electronic control panel. A vein on the side of her head pulsed. She didn't notice me staring back at her. Meanwhile, Ashley Hawking was grinning wide so I could see the edges of her smile from my seat directly behind her. Our mentor, the geek-famous inventor Henry Witherspoon, or Hank, glanced back at me from the co-pilot's seat, his awkward smile flashing too many teeth. Was he trying to make us feel better? If so, he was failing. Hank leaned over to Ashley. He held his hand out flat and swooped it up toward the roof of the cockpit. "Should we, you know, ascend?" "What?" Hawking asked. "No, of course not. Ascend? I thought you knew."
"Knew what?"
Hawking let go of the controls and waved her hands in a sweeping motion. She sighed with disappointment.
"This is one of yours."
"One of my what?" Hank asked.
"One of your designs."
Hank spun in his seat, scanning the interior. His mouth was all bunched to one side. He was squinting, and he was completely stumped. Only Hank Witherspoon would struggle to recognize one of his own inventions. His mind was so productive that he dropped out new ideas with about as much thought as a chicken laying eggs. Matt reached forward with one of his long arms and pointed.
Cliff?
What was that?" Hawking yelled back.
We couldn't have been more than a few football fields away from the rock wall.
"I think he's wondering if we're planning to avoid that cliff," I said.
Below us, out the left side of the plane and far from the island, a large dock with two boats tied to the sides floated in the middle of the ocean. The water was neon blue and smooth as glass. We probably could have landed on it, but I hadn't noticed any pontoons when we climbed into the aircraft that morning. The thing clearly wasn't a seaplane. So the only safe choices were up, right, or left. And if Ashley Hawking didn't pick one of those soon, we'd keep heading straight into the cliffs. We'd be smashed to bits, and all the headlines would read, "Four geniuses die as plane crashes into tooth." No, I wouldn't be the fourth. That honor would belong to Ashley Hawking. The world would mourn the loss of the two accomplished adults and my brilliant brother and ingenious sister. Me? I might be mentioned in the story somewhere, but I'm no brainiac. I'm average. Maybe a little above, but not by much, and only through effort. I have to work hard and read all the time to keep up with the geniuses.
But anyway, back to that nasty 900-foot-tall cliff sticking straight up out of the water in front of us. Maybe the Millennium Falcon could have made the turn, swooping up at the last second, but I wasn't liking our chances. Ms. Hawking?
Ashley, I told you already, Ashley! And not because I think of you as an equal, not at all.
She laughed to herself.
I simply prefer the sound of my first name. Now, honestly, Hank, someone of your intelligence, I assumed you'd see.
Hank was panicking now, his head turning from side to side in jerks like a broken sprinkler. Suddenly, my sister leaned forward and pointed at a large orange button in the ceiling, covered by a clear plastic case.
Are you serious? She said with excitement. Is this the underplane?
Yes! Ashley fake headbutted the dashboard a few times, then looked up to the ceiling.
The child gets the answer, finally!
Although Ava was relieved, I found this news to be more than a little frightening. You made a plane out of underwear? I asked. The moment the words escaped, I realized I'd probably misunderstood. But no one noticed. Or at least, no one bothered to make fun of me. Not yet, anyway. Ava and Matt were pretty skilled at remembering my mistakes, though.
This is the underplane? Hank asked.
His eyebrows rose so high they nearly touched the top of his head.
You actually built it?
I did, but enough talk. You're right, Jack, she said, swiveling around to look me in the eye.
We are getting awfully close, aren't we?
I nodded. The acknowledgement was nice, but I really wanted her to turn back around.
Are we buckled? Good. Would you like to do the honors, Hank?
You've tested it?
Of course, once, but it worked beautifully. Go ahead, press it. Do it. Now.
You've only tested it once? On the dashboard between them, a number in the center of the screen was blinking red and decreasing rapidly.
Yes, once and 1,000 times in simulation. Be confident in your ideas, Hank. Press the button already.
She pointed to the flashing red number, which just kept dropping.
Really? Now, 300 meters is pushing things. I haven't felt this much adrenaline since I climbed Everest.
Matt mumbled something about the cliff. Hank hesitated. Ashley had manga eyes. I don't know what Ava was thinking or doing. But this was no time to sit and wait. I slouched forward in my seat, reached up with my right foot, flicked open the plastic covering, and kicked in the orange button with the heel of my high-top sneaker. Ashley let out a long, almost disappointed breath.
Finally, she said.
Hank had his right hand out, three fingers extended. He counted down from three. A moment later, the engine stalled. The aircraft turned strangely quiet, as if we were suddenly flying in a giant paper plane.
Now the chute? Ava asked.
Before anyone could respond, something exploded behind us. Yet nobody but me panicked. Ava put her hand on my shoulder.
A rocket-launched parachute, she explained. Don't worry, that was supposed to happen.
Firing a parachute out with a rocket didn't make sense to me, but the plane slowed, rattling like an old roller coaster, then began circling to the left, away from the cliffs. So I exhaled. The lonely floating dock came into view ahead of us. Out through the window, I noticed two wooden boats rounding the corner of the island. Matt was staring at his computer screen again, mumbling to himself. He had a big test coming up and he'd been studying constantly. One of the downsides of being a genius is that everyone expected you to ace all your tests. I don't think Hank cared, though. Matt put more pressure on himself than anyone else did. But was this really a good time to prepare for an astronomy exam? No. So I reached across and closed his laptop. He didn't protest, which was pretty much a thank you.
Wow, it works, Ava said.
I told you I'd tested it.
Yeah, once, Ava noted.
And 1,000 times in simulation, Hank added. The others laughed. Apparently, this was funny. Normally, I avoided asking for an explanation when everyone else understood. Hank was always saying there's no such thing as a dumb question, but I was pretty sure I proved him wrong twice a day. And I hated reminding them that I lived on a lower level of the brain game. But there were times I needed to know. What does in simulation mean? Ashley looked back at me like I'd just asked the difference between salt and pepper. It's a computerized version of reality, Jack, Hank explained. It's like the difference between street racer and an actual street race with real cars, Ava added. Now I understood. She knew how to speak my language. See, I was actually kind of awesome at street racer. And I had this feeling that I'd be a sick driver in the real world, too. A brown, wide-winged bird swooped in front of us. Is that a petrel? Matt asked. They're frequent visitors to the island, Ashley said. Great. Now they were bird-watching. And yet we were still in a plane without pontoons, gliding over the ocean without any clear runway in sight. Sure, we were finally descending. But the underplane turned about as easily as the Titanic. As we swung closer to the cliff, I held my breath. No one spoke. I'm not sure anyone even breathed. Ashley and Hank leaned to their left, as if that might help, and the tip of our right wing passed within 10 feet of the rocks. Next to me, Matt's face was still that greenish-white color, and he was breathing carefully and gripping the armrests with enough force to dent them. That was close, Ashley said, her voice more excited than relieved. So, what's next? I asked. Well, you see, this is the first phase of the transition, Hank said. The first parachute allows for a more gradual descent, but there's also a braking chute to slow us down further. And then? I pressed. Hank's eyebrows arched twice. Wait and see, he said. Ava tapped me on the shoulder. Don't worry, I think you're going to like this. It is called the underplane, after all. I still didn't get what boxers or briefs had to do with the five of us landing safely. But I wasn't about to ask. So, about that braking chute, can we use it now? Not until we slow to 30 miles per hour. Hank cocked his head to the side, struggling for a view of the parachute suspended above us. Amazing! Truly, I don't know how to thank you, Ashley. I never thought anyone would ever build one. The plane soared through a wide loop. We were still about the height of a 4-story building from the glassy sea. We swung toward the rock face of Nihoa again, only this time at half the speed and with much less chance of crashing. The color in Matt's face had not changed, but I knew better than to ask him how he was feeling. When Matt was hurt or sick, he didn't want anyone to know. He'd rather hide off by himself somewhere than let you see him aching. The two boats came into view again. They looked like museum pieces. The masts were tall, the sails all rolled up, and a few people on either side were digging into the water with long black paddles. What are those? I asked. Ashley Hawking squinted, gagged for a 3 count, then breathed in, shook her head, and smiled. Friends of mine, she said. They think we're enemies, but as I'm sure you know, kids, those two are one and the same. As Sun Tzu said, you should treat your enemies as if they are your best friends. Is he one of those jazz guys, Hank? I asked. Our mentor had strange taste in music, but I was growing to like some of the tunes. I'd been trying to learn their names to impress him. No, that's Sun Ra, and he only really began as a jazz pianist. Another jolt cut his answer short. Ava pointed to the control panel. Our speed was dropping rapidly, and we were circling closer and closer to the water. Hank turned. I thought he was checking to see if we were okay.
but he stared out the small rear-view window instead. His smile vanished.
"You used a larger braking chute."
"Yes," Ashley said. "I had to. In simulation, the chute you suggested didn't slow the plane quickly enough. Your design was completely inadequate. No offense."
Hank paused before answering, "None taken?"
We were at least a few city blocks away from the island, gliding through our third full circle, cruising at the speed of a bike down a steep hill, when the plane finally skimmed the surface of the sea. We bounced. Hank whooped. Ashley hollered. Then we bounced again and again, lower each time like a stone skipping across the water. Ava quietly beamed, and my still-green brother relaxed his grip. When we finally stopped, my heart was thumping. My hands were cramped. Apparently, Matt wasn't the only one squeezing the armrests. I looked out the window. We had to be a mile away from the shore. Was this really the right place to land? Were we floating? Or sinking? And what did all this have to do with underwear? Ecstatic, Hank pointed to the button on the roof, then asked Ashley, "May I?"
"You're the guest," Ashley said.
Hank pushed the button with the heel of his hand. Above me, something clicked. A thud followed somewhere behind us. Then two loud hisses on either side of the plane. Below me, I heard the sound of rushing water, like a quickly filling toilet bowl. Suddenly, I needed to go to the bathroom, but there were more important things happening. Glancing out the window, I noticed that the wings were dropping below the surface. The plane was sinking, and no one else on board seemed particularly bothered.
"This is supposed to happen?" I asked.
Matt pointed his thumb out the window and swallowed.
"Why not shed the wings?" he asked, struggling to get the words out.
"The aerodynamic profile of the wings is hydrodynamically efficient, too," Hank answered. "In both cases, you're just moving through a fluid." Ava put her hand on my shoulder. She wore several colorful beaded rings. "What he means," she began, leaning forward, "is that you don't need to drop the wings because..."
"I know," I said.
And I didn't, really, but the geniuses are always explaining things to me, and I wasn't in the mood for a lesson. So I pulled out my new notebook. Before we'd left for Hawaii, I had a great idea. Or a great idea for me, anyway. Whenever the geniuses said something I didn't understand, I'd jot down a little note about it, then do some research, later, and learn about it on my own. That way I wouldn't have to admit it when I wasn't following along. And sure, I could have checked on my phone, but then they'd notice. I held the notebook down in the space between my left leg and the side of the plane so Matt couldn't see, and scribbled "hydrodynamic" on a blank page. After a second, I added "sun something." Unfortunately, I'd already forgotten the name of the guy Ashley quoted. The plane was sinking faster. The dock with the two boats was only a few pool lengths away. Part of me wished we could have just swum over. But the blue water was already climbing up the sides. The surface reached the bottom of my window, then rose higher and higher until it climbed over the top. A few seconds later, the underplane dropped below the surface and began gliding down through the blue sea.
"Oh, right. The underplane, as in underwater plane, not an aircraft made out of old boxer shorts."
Our ride had transformed into a 6-seat submarine. Since we met Hank 7 months ago, I'd been introduced to all kinds of strange machines and vehicles and experiences. I'd been to the bottom of the world and fought off a crazy Australian and flown in an inflatable vehicle that wasn't supposed to fly. I'd even had some experiences with miniature subs, since my sister had built one. But I'd never been inside an actual submarine. And certainly not in the Pacific Ocean,
with who knows how much water or how many deadly creatures lurking below me. On the 1 to 10 scale of soul-stretching, brain-twisting experiences, I'd give this one a 14. The water was filled with specks that sparkled in the sunlight. A group of long silver fish darted past our windows. I'd always imagined that riding in a submarine would be like staring at the fish tanks in an aquarium. But now it felt as if we were the ones trapped in the tank. And I kind of wanted to get back to the air. "So that was fun," I said. "But can we go back up now?" My ears popped. "Up? Of course not," Ashley said. The underplane nosed down in the direction of the island. But we weren't going to Nihoa. Not yet. Far below us, an enormous, brightly lit underwater building hung below the dock. It looked like the headquarters of some kind of powerful secret society or nefarious villain. The outside was swarming with huge fish.
"You still want to go back up, Jack?" Ava asked.
I could practically hear her smiling.
"No,"
I said with a grin. "Not anymore." Chapter 2. The Bazillionaire's Baby. You probably know me, or the others, anyway. If you haven't read The Lonely Orphans, the best-selling book of poems my brother and sister wrote about us, then you might have seen the news about our recent adventure in Antarctica. That whole thing was supposed to be a secret. But when three kids and their brilliant mentor rescue a missing scientist and her world-changing discovery from a frozen wasteland, the public has a right to know. And if one of those kids accidentally sent all the details of that adventure to a few major reporters and minor Twitter gods, the others shouldn't have gotten so mad. They shouldn't have accused this innocent young individual of spreading the story because they believed his, or her, only goal was to win fame and fortune. That would be unfair. Mean, really. And besides, what's wrong with fame and fortune? I certainly won't tell you which one of us was the guilty party in that whole fiasco. Instead, we'll move on with our lives and the story, which started a few days before our ride in the underplane. Ava, Matt, and I are foster siblings. Although we're kids, Ava and I are 12 and Matt recently turned 16, we're actually adults in the eyes of the law. I know, it's weird. And it definitely confuses people, so I'll run through the basics. A little more than a year ago, we divorced our foster parents and convinced a judge to let us live on our own. Now we share a small apartment in Brooklyn, and a social services-appointed lady named Min checks on us every so often to make sure we're alive and functioning. Ava and I homeschool through online programs with a little added help from Hank. Matt just started his first year of college. Biologically, we're not related, and we definitely don't look anything like siblings. Matt towers over the both of us. His hair is short and dark, and he always has a slight tan. His large nose looks like it was carved by a chisel. And although he has the build of an athlete, the guy can't cross a room without bumping into something. Ava has coffee-colored skin, wide, bright eyes, and hair that's always yanked back in a ponytail. She insists she's taller than me, but I'm catching up. I'm easily the best-dressed member of our group. And I doubt either of them would disagree that I've got the best hair, too. Most of the time, we hang out at Hank's private lab. It's only a few blocks from our place, and it's pretty much the world's coolest clubhouse. A towering, wide-open space 10 stories tall, Hank's lab is filled with technological toys. He has self-driving cars, motorized chairs, and a catapult designed to launch people instead of boulders, which doesn't actually work. There are robots that crawl, walk, jump, fly, and even serve you pizza. One of the rooms is a perfect replica of the surface of Mars, only with normal gravity. And there's a massive dive tank for testing submarines and scuba suits. You're definitely not supposed to swim around in the tank, though. Not even when he's away on a trip. Also, this confuses people, but Hank's not our dad.
He's not just a teacher or a mentor or guide, though, either. I don't know how to explain it exactly. He's just Hank. And although he does a lot for us, we don't just run around the lab for fun. We help him out, too. And as a kind of reward, he took us down to the bottom of the world with him a little while back. What was supposed to be a kind of science-themed vacation turned into a pretty dangerous adventure. But that's another story. After we returned from that South Pole trip, we were just lying around the apartment in Brooklyn recuperating when Hank surprised us by inviting us on this journey. We asked a million questions. Why were we going? What for? Would we ride on a private jet? Okay, so that was my question. We'd taken one part of the way to the South Pole, and it was truly glorious. Hank didn't have too many answers for us, but only one thing really mattered to me. We'd been invited to Hawaii. Palm trees, pineapples, ridiculous shirts. I was ready to go right then and there. My siblings, though, were a little more curious. Matt and Ava pressed Hank with questions about who needed our help and why. Hank told us what he knew, but he filled it with way too many science and engineering terms. Here's my version. A very wealthy computer geek named Ashley Hawking had given a bunch of money to a young engineer who had some crazy new plan for generating electricity. Hawking tossed $30 million at the project, and once it was working beautifully, she organized this big public demonstration with Hawaiian politicians and leading business people in ribbons and these cool flowered leis and maybe even people in grass skirts. I don't know, I'm just guessing about that part. Anyway, the electricity plant totally flunked. So Ashley was totally embarrassed, and she and the engineer looked into what went wrong, and not long after that, they invited us out. Got it? Okay, good. As for why we got the invite, Hank suspected it was his own reputation as a problem solver, but I have a different theory. I think Ashley and her engineer friend were the victims of sabotage, and they probably read those news stories based on that innocent kid's leaks and figured we could solve their mystery too. Either way, whether it was a simple engineering flaw or a devious plot, we'd be able to help. Hank is a world-class scientist and inventor, and my siblings are getting smarter by the minute. They ask all the right questions and chase the answers like a pair of border collies racing after a tossed frisbee. As for yours truly, I'd been teaching myself more about the detective trade. Through a few thick books, mostly. But I'd also learned a surprising amount from a new animated series, Duck Detective, about a very resourceful fowl who solves mysteries on a crowded country farm. Anyway, the cool part is that Ashley specifically requested that we join Hank. She truly wanted our help, which made Matt and Ava about as happy as two goats at a salad bar. And I was curious, too. While the rest of them studied this electricity plant, I was going to find the crook who was trying to sabotage the project. We flew out to California first, on a regular old commercial plane, unfortunately. I sat next to a woman whose nostrils fluttered when she snored. Her breath smelled like a burrito, and I used the time to skim two books about Hawaii and a short novel about an old fisherman that Hank insisted I read. I also watched a few very instructive episodes of Duck Detective. 2 hours and several microwaved airport hamburgers after we landed in California, we jumped on another flight to the island of Kauai, a ridiculously lush paradise. Most of the homes and hotels were clustered in a few spots along the coast, and the rest of the land was blanketed with green trees and rushing with waterfalls. Our hotel, the Green Room Resort, was spectacular. The pool was as clear as bottled water. The Wi-Fi was delightful, and there was a 24-hour ice cream bar with at least 25 different toppings. I practically cried when a driver picked us up the day after we'd arrived and rushed us to a nearby airfield, where Ashley Hawking herself was waiting by the underplane. She didn't really look like a bazillionaire. In my mind, Someone that rich should be a crusty old wrinkled guy who scowls all the time and has huge unruly gray eyebrows. He should have a kind of sag or droop to his face, too, as if a bunch of invisible lead weights are hanging from his cheeks and jaw. But not Ashley. She was young and fit. She had short, bright red hair, dark brown eyebrows, thin rectangular glasses, and some kind of weird dark mole on her left cheek. At first, I thought it was a chocolate donut crumb. I was tempted to flick it off. She hurried across the blacktop. "Welcome, welcome!" she called out. Then she stopped, bit her lip, and squinted. "The Lays! I'm so sorry. I forgot the Lays!" Hank cupped his hand over his mouth and whispered my way. "The traditional Hawaiian wreath given during welcomes and farewells." I knew that. "Such a shame," she said. "I picked them out myself, too. Stephen will be furious. I assured him you'd be greeted properly." "It's nothing," Hank said. "We're just happy to be here, right, kids?" We agreed aloud. "Who's Stephen?" I asked. Ashley didn't answer. "Come, come, we have much to do." A few minutes later, we were up in the air, cruising north over the Pacific Ocean to the tiny island of Nihoa. And now we were down in that ocean, surrounded by water, gliding toward what looked like the world's second coolest clubhouse. Sure, I'm a little biased, but Hank's lab still ranked first. The building was shaped like a pentagon. I'd guess it was about 3 stories tall and as wide and deep as a basketball court. The middle was all windows, and a huge pipe extended from the left side of the building straight down into the deep blue sea. The pressure was getting to me. I pinched my nose and popped my ears. Then Hank passed us each a piece of gum. "Is that your house?" Ava asked. "My lab," Ashley said. "The headquarters of our operation." The water glowed around the outside. In one of the windows, I thought I saw a kid staring back at us, but then our lights glared off the glass and the mirage was gone. All kinds of fish lurked around the outside, including one long, thick gray creature that made me gasp. "Shark?" I muttered. "Beautiful, isn't she?" Ashley said. "I believe that's Elizabeth." "Jack's terrified of sharks," Matt explained. "Less so when they're named Elizabeth, but yes, they do frighten me. Is that really so strange?" "Any creature that has managed to survive numerous extinction-level events should be respected," Hank said. "Except maybe for the cockroach. Beautifully engineered, but just so annoying." "Is Elizabeth attracted to the lights?" "She is, yes. And we feed her, too," Ashley said. "You feed her?" I asked. The bazillionaire shrugged. "I like sharks." The underplane nosed toward the bottom of the lab, then glided underneath. As we approached, Ashley throttled back until we slowed almost to a stop. Everyone was quiet. The propellers stopped whirring. Ava pushed between Matt and me and held her index finger over the touchscreen. Eyebrows raised, she looked at Ashley for approval. "We're going up, right?" "That's right. Go ahead." Ava tapped the screen. As something hissed below us, she explained, "We're pumping water out of the ballast tanks. Once they're filled with air, the underplane will be buoyant and we'll start to float up." Matt pressed his fist to his mouth, then asked, "To the surface?" "Not yet," Ashley said. "First, the tour." The underplane rose up through a hole in the bottom of the lab, then burst from the water like a whale breaching for a gulp of air. The vehicle rocked back and forth. My hands were pressed against the back of Ashley's leather seat. Hank started thinking aloud. "There must be some way to smooth that out, a control system of some kind." A thin layer of water on my window cleared. I untucked my shirt and wiped away the condensation. We'd popped up in a kind of pool in the middle of a blue and white room with tiled floors.
"A moon pool," Hank remarked. "How clever."
"Looks like the deck at the YMCA," Ava said.
My sister was right, except for one thing.
"No old people, though," I noted.
The motor purred as Ashley steered the underplane to the edge.
A small goateed man, who appeared to be made entirely of muscle, reached out, grabbed the underplane by the bow, and pulled it closer. Holding a rope, he signaled Ashley.
"Oh, right," she said. "I forgot."
She tapped the touchscreen. Something clicked in the front and back of the plane.
"Cleats,"
she said, "so that we can tie up securely like a normal boat.
And they're hidden inside so they don't disrupt the aerodynamics in flight," Hank said.
That sounded like something Matt would have noticed, but my brother was still quiet. His eyes were closed, his lips pressed tight.
"Nice touch, Hank," Ava remarked.
Hank scowled. "That wasn't my idea."
"Oh, come on," Ashley said. "Nobody invents in a vacuum. Well, except maybe that British guy who reinvented the vacuum."
"He didn't reinvent it," Hank muttered. "He merely made it look cooler."
"Who's that?" I asked, pointing to the human-shaped boulder.
"That's Kildare, my seal," Ashley said.
"Like Navy SEAL?"
"Yes, everyone in the valley has one. Once you get 100 million, you basically have to get your own seal. He's my bodyguard. Now I'm asking him to take over security down here at the lab, too. Although I'll still come first. I always do."
The underplane stopped rocking. Our doors swung up and open, and we climbed out along the wings and onto the delightfully solid tiled floor. There were puddles of water all around us. I should have warned Matt, but watching him slip and fall would have been nice after such an intense trip, so I kept quiet.
"Thank you, Kildare," Ashley said. "Where's Stephen?"
"I believe he's here. He insisted on taking Luther himself."
"Well, it is his boat," Ashley replied. "Don't you think he has that right?"
Kildare didn't answer.
"You can get here by boat, too?" Matt asked.
"Well, yes. I mean, we can't all travel in via underplane now, can we? There's a dock on the surface, accessible by boat, and stairs from there down to the lab. Does Stephen know his guests are here?"
"I believe so," Kildare said.
"Who's Stephen?" Ava asked.
Ashley ignored her.
"And Rosa?"
"In the control room. She's waiting for you."
"Well, then let's go," she said. "Hank?"
Our mentor was crouching beside the underplane, with one hand flat on the body. His starry eyes were filled with tears, like a mother gazing proudly upon one of her children. Matt handed me his computer, and I thought he was going to kneel beside Hank, but then he leaned over the edge of the moon pool. Some kind of monstrous combination of a cough and a burp erupted from his stomach. I backed away. And then it happened. A volcanic explosion from my brother's stomach. He'd been trying to eat more like Hank lately, salads and greens and all kinds of vegetables. Now, as he dropped to his hands and knees, spewing into the moon pool, the remains of his new diet were floating atop the surface like chopped lilies on a pond. A few little fish kicked to the surface, nibbling at his upchucked lunch.
"Gross," Ava said. "They're eating your—"
"I know," Matt growled.
Hank lifted a hand to his chin. "Fascinating, right? The cycle of life. No wasted nutrients or energy. Are you okay, Matthew?" My brother held up a hand. Once his retching slowed down, I crouched close and whispered,
"Careful when you get up. There are puddles everywhere."
Hank started to get our bags out of the cargo hold. Ashley insisted that she'd have someone take care of them, so we just grabbed our backpacks instead. I held Matt's for him and slid his computer inside, but it was heavier than I'd expected.
What's in here?
Matt started to answer, then unloaded again.
A telescope, I think, Ava said.
Mine was filled with candy bars. In Antarctica, chocolate and caramel were part of your basic survival kit. So I figured, why not Hawaii, too? I'd stuffed in a few other random items, but the treats were precious. A door behind me swung open. Kildare lifted his left hand, palm facing out, like he had Iron Man-style lasers hiding in there somewhere. Yet we weren't being attacked. A boy about my height and age stepped into the room, followed by a tall young woman with buzzed black hair, huge bright eyes, and dark brown skin. Her lips gleamed, and she stared at Ava for a few seconds before turning her radiant smile on Hank.
Dr. Witherspoon, I'm Rosa Morris. I took one of your seminars when you were a guest teaching at Caltech a few years.
He jabbed his index finger in the air, pointing at her. Then he stopped.
Bix!
Excuse me?
I remember you. Bic pens. You chewed on those cheap plastic pens while you were listening, right?
She pulled a mangled blue pen out of her pocket.
Still do. They help me concentrate.
There are worse habits. He prefers jazz and sandals, I said.
What?
Rosa asked.
Wait, stop, Ashley said. I'm the host here, yes? Remember? Now, introductions. First and foremost, this is my son, Stephen.
The kid in question stared at us like we were no more interesting than a few specks of dust. He was about my height. His blonde hair was long and wavy, as if it had been years since his last visit to the barber, and he wore a white t-shirt with a vaguely familiar symbol on the chest, a blue blazer, and black high-top sneakers. His clothes were fine. I had no real problem with them. But there was something about his hair, the arch of one of his eyebrows, and the mathematically straight line formed by his pressed lips that suggested he was going to be difficult. He'd been holding his hands behind his back, but then he raised one to wave, and in the other I could see that he had a copy of The Lonely Orphans. Which was great. Really. Just what I needed, you know? Another devoted fan of the geniuses. Matt and Ava would be thrilled.
Greetings, he said.
Then he glanced at me.
Nice bow tie.
I didn't have to be a mind reader to know he didn't mean that.
Was it coming loose?
I reached up and adjusted the knot.
Wait, Matt said. He stifled a burp, then continued. Your name is Stephen?
Yes.
So you're named after Stephen Hawking, the famous cosmologist.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.